So I guess I'm going to talk a little about Mexico. I've been there, I've driven there, through it, all around its coast, and it's very good and bad. So it has good things and bad things. So I don't know. Anyway, on the way there, yeah, you need to mark your boxes, have any, numbers. Each box has to have a number to say the number five and number, and then write it down a list. Say number five is the books. Yeah, so I have a lot of books, so it's kind of fun in a way because it's like whatever you call it, escuela. I'm already in escuela. It's ridiculous. So yeah. Kind of fun, yeah. So I was given the invite, my father and I, to go to Mexico. It's very, very tempting, isn't it? So all I can do is get ready. And yeah, why not? Why not? So there. What else did I have to say? Yeah, the ride down there is gonna be the worst because yeah, if you don't have the truck, they don't allow the rental cars through, so or the rental trucks through. So you have to use like a one of those companies, like a motorcade company that does it, like a trucking firm. And I guess that would be the like one of those ABFs or something. They used to have the UPAC down there, but they closed shop a year ago, so no UPAC. That's a shame because they were kind of cool. And yeah, it's a shame. But anyway, yeah, so that's the drama. Anyway, what was I talking? We're talking about, I don't know, politics. I don't know how the pull of politics, how it does really pull away from yourself. Pulls. When you hear negatives in the news and negatives and all of this, it's just a real like what? It's just like somebody else's glamour. Negative glamour is in preference for the stage, in preference to the stage over yourself, So when we're looking at this Trump thing, and it's just like, what has he done now? I'm waiting for. I guess I was gonna look for the website. Where is the website that says what has he done now? Because it's really what it's all about. It's just this. You look at him as this alter ego self, human. That is there, that's just punching and punching at anything that is a liberal aspect. Yeah, I had no idea he was that aggressive towards liberal politics. I had no idea. And it's just becoming a, yeah, it's just pouring it on thicker and thicker. So it's pretty bizarre. Yeah. Anyway, Mexico's kind of fun idea. My mother, she was down there. She was born there, and she lived there much of her childhood and her teenage years. So yeah, she was a wild party animal, and yeah, she played around with the big heavies of leadership down there, in I don't know, the generals, attorney generals, and presidentes, and yeah, they're pretty clicky that way. When you have the money, this was all before the peso drop, the major peso drop, the one where it went to three. I think it was the one that went to three. Yeah, the peso plummeted, and it was a really terrible one. And there was another one that after that, and it went to eight. I believe, went from 3 to, and then I went later on, went to 8, but yeah. Yeah, so her life, she was brought up as a debutante. She lived a life of a debutante, and the peso dropped. So for her, it was just like the carpet out from underneath. No more of that party. You know, she couldn't do that type of party anymore. Because, you know, money is the twist that twines that group, you know. And when you don't have the money to twist and twine with that group, you know, it's all you have is your friendship visits. And but you, so much of their life is entwined with business and politics in Mexico. So it was a tough time. There was a man there that was in love with her, and he had a terrible time after the peso drop, after Mary left. He became an alcoholic and died a year early. Early man, an early death, you know, love in his life, you know. But that is money, you know, money does that. Money is the killer to that type of situation, you know, in their little circle, you know, them, you know, being the federales, essentially, of an entire region. When that little circle, you know, is disrupted, you're not allowed to play that game anymore. There's those enfaticos. No, you can't have her. She's out of your league now. She's not in your league. You understand? Even love is not allowed in that league, because there's money in the middle of the picture. So yeah, it's a great separado. The what do we call it, the desperado separado, money. Yeah, so it was a tragedy, and then she had these ridiculous 4 redheaded children, on the tragedy of his love loss, you know. So yeah, he was forever unhappy after that. Just awful. Yeah, some people really, I don't know, we have different complexities when we talk about love and its reach, you know. Some people are just like the moon, you know, the biggest moon in the world, you know, with love expressed. And others, you know, they harden away from those moments, like, no, it's just... Some people really keep it, though. They keep it. Yeah. And I think they can keep it, though. I think they can keep it, though, because of their constants. I'll say their constants of money supply. I really think love is an extra. Is an extra, what do we call it? An extra satisfaction, a hug, an extra contentment that we're allowed when we have huge, ridiculous amounts of wealth. It helps for a constant relationship. So that was the drama there. Yeah. When you're decreed, no, you can't any longer, because no longer in our league, not in our set, not in our clique, not allowed to be in our clique, do you understand? When the money is not there, when the pesos are gone, you know, certain people just are not allowed to be at those parties. They're not allowed to play the game any longer. So yeah, so my mother just lived a tragic life on the other side of poverty after that. She could not adapt. She never adapted to American society. She was always the gregarious, wealthy, rich in her self, in her ego. She couldn't stop being that. Yeah. But anyway, yeah. So she lived in her shelter of school after all the children. She lived in the shelter of school and went to school and went to school and went to school. She went to another university and another university and another university. She just kept going to universities. So she lived there as a harbor. That's where she lived. That was her new allow, you know. But yeah, what were they doing down there before the peso dropped? And it just happened to be the hinge there on my mother also, her leaving the door on the drop. I don't know. We can go back into you know, the decadence of you know, because I even have pictures of the Federales themselves, you know. I have pictures. So she was that close to the group, and I don't know, what were they doing? And when you have an area, you know, you have a region of the world, and it's just your little political game, you know, they're just the rules. Just the rules being stated. It's just our life, and that's the way it's done. And yet, I look at my mother as a guide. I look at her as a guide forever. A guide to initiation in school, initiation in donations, initiation in all of these things when it comes to the impoverished. My mother was always very giving that way. Schooling being the most important for children. Donations also being very important. So we have those strongholds that she just never went away from. And when I say schooling, it also means the schooling of everyone, not just the children. I mean schooling, the continued schooling. And schooling about nature, schooling about wildlife, schooling about plants. Botanicals. The more people that are schooled in botanicals, you know, this is a chestnut tree, the more people that are schooled in, this is a hawthorn tree, the more appreciation when we identify those. So those are, it's a very difficult class. When we go to school, those are some of the most difficult classes in school because they go with all of the serrations of the leaves themselves. Very, very tough. Very tough to work through and figure it out. You know, which one is that? Which one is that? You know, ginkgo biloba is easy. You know, it's that twittery one. You know, there's you know, but when you have to take that type of class, yeah, it can be tough. I today had to throw away some old. Yeah, they're leaves. They're her leaves. But yeah, I just had to throw them away. They're leaves under plastic, and so that's what the botanicals classes do. They do these in college. They take the leaves and they stick them underneath plastic, on a piece of paper, and then they write their genus, their botanical name down. And so because they're writing that botanical name down, they have all kinds of, you know, smarts. But because they're so smart there, that's the problem in a way. It's very much so a problem, you know, because there's the identification when you're a young child, and you go, this is a tree, blah, 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 you know, but then there's, as you're getting into college and not getting into college and never taking that, even if you went to college, you know, so then botanicals themselves start to become like this something for, like if you're like a nutty professor, way off, and you're taking school for 12 years of your life, at least, higher education for 12 more years. So when we're looking at that going on in the lower classes, I'm not seeing it. I'm not seeing botanicals being taught. That's very unusual. So yeah, so that botanical appreciation, you know, because there can be a beautiful forest, and somebody cuts down the trees just intermittently, but they cut down the wrong ones and go, no, those were the ones that were very rare, And so you needed to save those ones and maybe pluck out these others. You know, so maybe they didn't even notice the difference of the trees, you know. So this type of thing, you know, that's very, very important. Education. Education. So that was all she could do in after the peso drop was just be an education pusher. And unfortunately, I don't know, I don't think I came up to bat for her. My brain power, my brain prowess, I don't know. Sometimes I thought I was really, really smart, and I, you know, I look at my test scores test scores to get into college, and they looked phenomenal, and it said, you know, at Pepperdine I was like 22% higher than the average for mathematics, and 20% higher I was like 35% higher in verbal. So I'm like, well, gee whiz, I'm amazing. Maybe I'm a genius. I said, well, that's ridiculous. And so then I look up these scores look up the score place online. So we look at the, I'm looking at these, and it just looked like I was average. So maybe the year that I graduated, they changed the test scores. They changed them another way. I swear, because Pepperdine thought I was a genius. So something happened there. Something happened at Pepperdine that they thought I was a genius. So who knows? Who knows what happened? But so I'll still go with their rules and their test score pull out through there. Yeah. Because what? Yeah. 70, I was very high, very smart mathematically, which was unusual because I didn't think I was that smart mathematically. But later on, yeah. I don't know. I didn't mean to talk about myself. That's not really an education for anybody, is it? But yeah, what was I saying? We were talking about the externalizing. The externalizing moments of ourself, being interrupted, because there's an externalizing moment, like, you know, your relationship with the world, and then you have all of a sudden, you have all of a sudden just somebody else's, like, blast, negative blast, you know. And so we're looking at this Trump situation being this huge negative blast. Just being an interrupter to your flow, to your direction, to your palace of life. You know what I mean? So you, Mr. Trump, I don't know. I think you just have to cool it, you know? Don't be so aggressive to people. I don't even know why you would have to be that aggressive in business. I just think it's all wrong. I think the whole process is wrong. Yuck. Anyway, good night.